Hello.
Hello, it's Trux.
It's another guest Trux.
Who do we have in the cab today, Josh?
Somewhat astoundingly, we have Will Toledo from Car Seat Headrest. Hello.
Hello.
What are we talking about? None of us really know.
I had a couple of ideas about this.
We're astoundingly unprepared.
Yeah. I was informed that I'm going to be talking about masculinity and the artistic imperative. Is that right?
Yeah, that was. Those are pretty much the words that I typed without thinking about them too much earlier. And, you know, I've had a chance to think about them a little bit more. But before we get into that, I think we need to acknowledge that you are by far the most famous person we've ever had on Trux. And so it seems like we should break from the format of Trux a little bit to ask you a few showbiz questions beforehand.
Just to
make sure that you're comfortable before we get into the sort of Trux idiom.
Right. Answering showbiz questions is probably your favorite thing, right?
Yeah, this is going to make me very comfortable.
All right, excellent. Josh, would you like to favor him with one?
Yeah, actually, I wanted to ask what it feels like when NPR says you made a better album than David Bowie did.
Oh, did they do that?
Yeah, they did. They put you number one on the list.
One guy did that. One guy does it. I'm okay with it. I don't know about the official list. Yeah. It's weird. I mean, you know, there have been a lot of year-end lists, and I don't necessarily agree with the entire concept. I definitely don't know if there are 50 good albums that get released in a year.
There we go. Go ahead. we haven't really delved into the feeling part of this yet. What does it feel like to be objectively better at making music than David Bowie was?
I'm not. That's the thing.
Are you sure about that? Because that's a pretty reliable source.
I just wanted to ask you the worst possible interview question.
So that it can be all uphill from here, frankly.
Yeah.
That's cool.
Yeah, no, I mean, I think that just to clear the air, I think we can all agree that the best album that came out this year was Interventions by Horse Lords, and so there's no contest.
Have you ever listened to Horse Lords?
I think you might.
I have not.
I think you might like Horse Lords. There's a little bit of Lungfish in there, and I know that you dig the Lungfish occasionally.
I do like Lungfish.
But yeah, no, dude, masculinity and art is what I wanted to talk about, but more particularly the responsibility to make moral art and the responsibility to make good art, because I've heard you talk about this sort of thing occasionally.
Have you? Occasionally.
Occasionally, like, you know, once or twice.
When I surface, yeah.
Yeah. And also in public forums, like, I read a review recently that you did of Life of Pablo by Kanye West, which you began by saying that it was a morally... What was the word?
Repulsive.
Repulsive, that's right. A morally repulsive record, but one which you enjoyed anyway. And you explained pretty, you know, in a good and thorough manner the ways in which you enjoyed it, despite it being a morally repulsive record. But you didn't spend a lot of time talking about what about it was morally repulsive.
That's true.
And I thought that that might be a good jumping off point, because...
Well, it's not, because... I approach morality and art in a very indirect way. You know, that's not really... That's never how I look at art, basically.
Okay.
You know, I... in my opinion, most of the time, making good art means making moral art, basically. You know, if your art is good 90% of the time, it is also going to have good morals, just because... you know, art is about looking at humanity, and usually when you look at humanity closely enough to be able to make good art, you come away with a certain sense of what is good and bad and what you should do. And I don't know, Kanye is in a special area where I think that he does know what is good and bad about humanity, and he chooses to not care about that when he makes his album. And so Kanye is an exception to the rule, and we should probably not start with him.
He's a hot button right now, too, in a way that is making everybody uncomfortable.
Yeah, the Kanye discourse is incredibly complicated at the moment. Maybe we can circle back to it after we've had a good running start.
Maybe.
Yes, I think
but
so.
The idea then is that art that is good, i.e. art that we can enjoy with our eyes fully open, has to stem from an understanding of the way that things are, which is thorough enough to avoid like basic pitfalls about the way, about an understanding about the way things work.
Yeah. I mean, not even talking about art, I think that a lot of immorality stems from just laziness. You know, people know what the good thing is, and they know what the good thing should be, but they don't care enough. And that applies to art as well. A lot of bad art is lazy, and its laziness makes it bad, and also makes it not as morally sound as it could be.
I feel as if this is something we've said almost on Treks in the deep past.
Oh yeah?
Yeah, once upon a time. I think it was about a movie. But yeah. In other words, we are inclined to agree, I think.
I mean, on the one hand, we are inclined to agree. On the other hand, this project is dedicated to an aesthetic of the slapdash.
Sure.
I feel so. Like,
yeah, we are kind of.
We investigate themes of laziness.
We're exemplars of the lazy.
I don't know if that makes us lazy or not, but I'm feeling attacked. No. No, I. It's interesting to me because, like, the. There are works which are, like, clearly labored over, and produced, and which seem to be thoughtless. Mm-hmm. Underneath the labor, there seems to be this point where craft departs from worth, if you know what I mean. So, like, I think I want to back up and say, where do you get the feeling of good art from? Like, I feel from my discussions with you in the past that, like, this comes from a really certain place for you to be able to distinguish good art from bad art. And I want to know whether that's based more in the head, more in the heart, somewhere else.
Good art is what makes me feel good.
Yeah. It's a solid definition.
Good art is that which transcends the social object that it is, something that is greater than, you know, my imagined entry point into this discussion was actually Star Wars. I saw the last film I did, was that last year? I
think The Force Awakens, yeah.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah.
My dad around there, around that's the only thing I remember.
I think
that.
Star Wars is a Christmas movie from now on.
Yep.
Yeah. And that was the first time I'd really encountered the phenomenon, you know, the social phenomenon of Star Wars. I was obviously familiar with the films and their reputation, but this was the first time I was coming face to face with people who really, really cared about this franchise. And we went to see it like at least a month after it came out, and there were still, you know, hardcore fans in the audience. And, you know, I watched the film, and it was okay. You know, it was not great, and it was not bad either. But, you know, what was most interesting about it to me was seeing this thing, you know, this greatly beloved work, and just wondering, you know, what effect would it have had if everything about this was better, you know, if the actors had delivered just show-stopping performances, if the script had been taken, you know, to the Coen brothers or whatever, and just, you know, it had been structured in a much more compelling and original way so that it could be sort of held up, you know, 20 years down the line in a screenwriting class, would that have made any difference? You know, would people have liked it more? Would more people have liked it? Or would it actually have not gone over as well because it didn't, you know, and that was the first time I sort of realized that there are two different things that you're seeing when you're looking at art, which is there's the social phenomenon or the social object, and then there is the art itself.
Which are incredibly difficult to separate because
they're impossible to separate.
Capable of stepping outside of our cultural context and
absolutely
is one or the other. Sorry, is one or the other more important to you?
Oh, absolutely. The art itself is absolutely more important to me, and you know, this is where my perspective comes from, and it's why I'm less inclined to look at the moral side of things, because morality in art is more concerned with the social apparatus, and goodness in art comes from the art itself.
Hmm. Okay. Can I ask you a question then?
Sure.
Your art, so you look to the sort of the eternal, the transcendental in art, but your art is very personal. Like, the narratives that your music runs on are very distinctly derived from your personality and your context.
Sure. But I hope that there is something that can be transcended through personal means.
Absolutely. I'm just wondering, would you prefer to have, like, every, like, demographic consideration about yourself erased when people listen to what you're thinking? Do you want to be listened to as sort of, as, like, a... Would you prefer to be listened to sort of as a blank source of music, or as the personality that people are interacting with when they hear your lyrics?
I would, but I've given up hope on it, because that's just not how people experience art. You know, when I started Car Seat Headrest, it was a completely anonymous project. I didn't attach my name to it, and I wasn't really pulling lyrics out of anywhere. You know, I was just generating content intentionally as blank a manner as possible.
Okay.
You know, that kind of art has already always interested me. I was, you know, going off of Jandek and outsider artists like that. But it's too hard. People latch on to whatever they can, and I found that I was being pulled into my art in that personal way. But I also found that it was more rewarding to put myself into the art and to have that personal connection with it. And, you know, along the way, it became, you know, it did a 180, and I went from being trying to be completely anonymous to being, you know, resigned to having my personality attached to the art. And, you know, now the idea is to, you know, keep them as separate as possible as far as the social presentation of the art and the art itself, while keeping both in mind and not screwing one over by emphasizing the other. And it's a difficult balance.
I thought there was gas there, and I was wrong, for those wondering.
Sorry, Josh had to explain the trunk problem.
That's okay, I was done.
I felt it was important to acknowledge. But that is an interesting viewpoint.
Yeah, I think of somebody like Vince Staples, who I keep mentioning him on Trucks, who says that the basic value of art is honesty. But he's also very much sees himself as a purveyor of a product, in a way that he views his presence, his imminence in the work, as the thing that is sold.
Right.
And therefore, the more imminence there is, the better a quality of product that results, which on the one hand is sort of, you know, feels a little, you know, mercenary and crass. On the other hand, just offers this really sort of compelling results-based way to look at what makes good art and what doesn't, if you know what I mean.
Yeah, I mean, that's one way of resolving the conflict between the two, is that you become the art yourself. And the downside of that is that you remain a human being, and it can be hard to be art sometimes.
Some people seem to enjoy it, I suppose.
People are built for it, yes.
Thrive on it.
It's good to be able to put on and take off the duck hat or whatever it is that you end up doing. So here's the question. Do you view your creative output then, like, as we sort of started by being flippant about the fact that Rolling Stone thinks that you made the best album of 2016?
I thought it was NPR.
It's both. Okay. I'm sorry to tell you. And I can't believe that we're telling you that.
We might be wrong. I don't know.
Nah. Josh is telling me this. It's possible that he made all of this up and that nobody
I thought I heard Jimmy Fallon say that when I watched that.
Oh, no. He was obviously lying.
We're number 4 on Rolling Stone.
The 4th best.
I am not unaware. Pretty good. Pretty unfortunately.
Good. I imagine it is hard to be unaware of something like that.
Would you prefer to be?
Prefer to be what? Unaware?
Would you prefer to be completely shielded from all of this?
Honestly, only the bad stuff. What's frustrating is that the Rolling Stone came out and I was psyched, and then I've been pretty much lower on every list since then.
Oh, man. So it was... you got that one guy at NPR to come back to, you know.
Yes,
I'm sure
Bob.
Is the one with the best taste.
Bob
but anyway, right.
Kind-hearted soul.
But yeah, so like going, so this is a thing, right? You know, putting your art into the world and having your art interact with other art into the world. And we tend to frame these things as struggles, you know, and as a battle between one vision and another, particularly in rock and roll and in genres which have wherein like technical skill and aggression are significant. And so like how do you view yourself in relation to shit, basically? Because there's a lot of it out there, you know?
What kind of shit?
Bad art.
I try to avoid it, usually.
Yeah, but you put your shit out there, which is not shit. You put your non-shit shit out there, and it coexists with shit. And
I see.
They struggle against each other in a lot of different ways. They struggle against each other in terms of competing for listeners. They struggle against each other in terms of competing for critical legitimacy. Are you invested in that in any way?
I try not to be. I don't want that to be my bag. You know, I just want to... I'm mainly concerned with the creation of art. Mm. And once it's released, I try and forget about it and move on. You know, I hate the last record we did.
Oh, really? The one that everybody likes.
Yeah, the one that everybody... And, and a lot of is to my personality. I find it hard to like popular music. And
Horse Lords, man. You'll enjoy Horse Lords.
I need to go deeper.
it has no feelings, but it has all the feelings as a result of having no feelings. Mm-hmm. That's where the bag is.
Autechre.
The album of the year, as far as Josh is concerned, is the Autechre 4 disc record thing that they put out. Which
it's so good.
I admire him for being able to experience in a way that I can't.
A few episodes ago, Isaac said that we need some music that people can get out onto the streets to, and I'm thinking, oh man, what if we just like filled the streets with that horrible electronic noise? That would make a statement, and that would be very difficult for the capitalism machine to reprocess and regurgitate. Yeah,
they'd find a way.
Yeah, they would, I suppose.
I learned today that there is a musical genre called Fashwave.
For fascists. Yeah, I've heard of that.
It's really bland techno, which I guess is not a surprise. Complexity is the enemy of this kind of ideology.
Fascist music already exists. Not gonna name any names.
Oh, come on, name a name. And then get him to endorse it. Let's start over. Let's get some controversy, I think.
I mean, I would say that if you want to listen to the music that fascists, or like really, not fascists necessarily, but people on the internet who are really enthusiastic about fascism, like it's going to be, unfortunately, it's going to be vaporwave in some cases, which, but in other cases, it's going to be like your black metal and all that, you know, your angry young men music.
Right. So either nihilism via ultimate irony or nihilism via zero irony.
Yeah.
I've been told that it is wrong to listen to Skrillex for the same reasons.
I've heard that going around. I don't understand it. I don't totally understand the argument. Do you have a better sense of it than I do?
As far as I understand it, if a group of people listen to music that you don't like, after a certain point it becomes immoral. But this is the viewpoint yes. that I was presented with. This is not the viewpoint that I endorse, and I also happen to like Skrillex. So I'm going to dismiss it. But this is a guy who probably is really into Autechre, so.
it's the simpler a beat is, the easier it is to march to it. Let's see anybody try to march to Autechre.
Right.
Exactly.
On the other hand, as the communists on my Tumblr wall are learning, physical fitness may not in fact be a tool of the hegemony, and we might actually need people who can fight coming up. So, you know, maybe we can have people marching along to like...
Why am I stopping for gas again?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's because you're enraptured in this discussion of fascist and non-fascist musical arts.
And I guess I should be clear that if you listen to black metal, I'm not judging you, and I don't think you're a fascist for that reason alone.
John Darnielle is a is a big old goose stepper.
Oh my god, where am I?
Yeah, no, it's like...
I shouldn't say that. I was about to spread rumors.
What? No. Please tell all. We need as much attention as we can get.
I won't get specific, but a certain indie rocker of acclaim asked our guitarist if he was a fascist because he was wearing boots. I forget. There's a specific type of boots that you're not supposed to wear, and he was wearing a ministry shirt, too. And the overall combo presented a certain aesthetic, which apparently is shared by fascists.
This asshole.
Well, I mean, this is the thing. It is definitely... I mean, I remember watching a documentary about anti-fascist skinhead movements in France in the 80s.
I'm entranced by this truck move.
Yeah, this is a real problem.
This guy left me no choice.
You're going to have to move him with your body, Josh.
God, I tried and failed. No, I'm in a real jam. Why? If only I hadn't stopped for unnecessary gas.
By Ray's Hamburgers.
Yeah.
All right. So, but yeah,
I missed the point there. What was
the point? The point was that somebody asked Mr. Carseat Headrest, guitarist. I mean,
right.
I have a problem where I will continuously refer to people by their internet names. So you are Carseat Headrest, as far as I'm concerned, despite the name that Josh said earlier on in the conversation. But your guitarist, who's also part of Carseat Headrest and therefore an organ of you, was questioned about being a fascist because he was wearing a ministry t-shirt and army boots, essentially, or Doc Martens, probably.
Yes, that's the boot. That's the boot.
And there was 30 years ago, there was a big movement by anti-fascist skinheads to reclaim this particular look from fascists so that they could basically have street fights with Nazi punks. Mostly happened in Europe, but also in like LA and various places. And my opinion about that is that it is useful to be prepared to kick people in the head if they're coming to kick you in the head, which makes me slightly more aggressive than some, slightly more progressive than others.
Arm the left.
Our guitarist is definitely not prepared to kick anyone in the head, which is the irony.
Yes.
Anyways,
well, for
no
him, it's just a fashion statement,
that.
Therefore probably fascism. You should maybe interrogate his political underpinnings.
No one felt good about that situation.
I'm sorry.
That's okay.
I've been thinking about Muse lately.
You think they're latent fascists? They're definitely, you know.
This is probably not the turn that I wanted this episode to take.
You know, that's the good point of being in the position that we are in, is that we have nothing to lose from slandering everybody with wild imagination.
It's very true.
And everything to gain, really.
The reason I've been thinking about Muse lately is because I watched the latest Alan Curtis documentary, and twice in that movie he uses the phrase, "Their time was running out," and just all of a sudden the song Muse, "Our Time is Running Out," came back into my head for the first time in like a decade. And I was reminded all of a sudden that a lot of Muse's lyrics, when they were at their quote-unquote best, I guess, the moment when I liked them anyway, back when I was a teen.
Same thing as we've already established in this conversation.
Exactly. A lot of their lyrics were about really being angry at the Bush administration, and that's something that I had totally forgotten and is starting to feel relatable again in their silly, silly music.
Perhaps it is time for Muse to come back and save us once again.
I mean, they never stopped doing it. I went back and looked at their latest music video, and it's about, like, futuristic riot police, like, fucking up a protest, and I don't know what Muse's deal is. Anyway.
Well, it's more interesting to talk about what kinds of instrumental music that have simple basic shapes in their videos are fascists and which aren't than it is to, you know, get
we've
behind
people. We've
possibly
covered that already.
Yeah, I think we probably have. So let's move away from
fascism?
Accusing people of being terrible. let's move from fascism to
we didn't talk about masculinity.
We didn't talk about masculinity yet, and I did promise that to Tumblr.
Yeah,
and
that's
true.
So what do you see? What do you see as being the connection here?
I was sort of moving toward it when I was talking about, like, you can put your art out into the world because you have no choice. You can put it out into the world because you are trying to become better. You can put it out in the world because you are aiming to disrupt the narrative that already exists, you know? And my Jungian upbringing would tell me that, you know, masculinity is less about being a dude and more about a certain kind of approach to life, which is about seeking the transcendent and destroying everything in your path.
The quest.
And in order to get to the transcendent. And of course, all of that is very much out of date now, and is, you know, has been ground beneath the boot heels of a dozen innovations in personal gender logistics. But the reason that I brought it up to begin with is because it oh my god, I was really hoping I was going to have an end to this sentence, but
what's the opposing side here? What is the feminine way of making art?
Good question. That challenges the whole damn paradigm, doesn't it?
I mean,
I may have an answer.
Why don't you hang yourself on this one so that I don't
okay.
have to?
Okay. This is something Amanda Palmer recently contributed to a compilation for something. And there's a Pitchfork review about the album that expressed surprise that the Amanda Palmer song would be good because people on the internet don't like her.
Right.
And this surprised me, because usually when a musician makes good music, you can kind of rely on them in making good music. But she is, yeah. And also, I don't really get... I get it, but... It's interesting the ways in which Amanda Palmer is not liked by the internet, because I think that she does kind of embody a feminine way of doing art, which is that, she is not doing that quest, you know, the quest that is climbing to the top of the music industry as it stands in 2016. She is doing her own thing. She's got a Patreon. And she's got a kid, and she's got a husband, and she's doing all that stuff, and kind of just thriving in her own world. And people are supporting her to do that. And that seems to me to be an alternative mode, and to be kind of an unmasculine mode. And I think that that is a large part of why people dislike her, is because that stands as one of the clearer examples of an alternative to masculine mode.
Yeah, I think it was possibly one of the sort of those perfect cultural microcosms when she and Steve Albini got in a fight.
Yeah, exactly. You
know, it's like both of them, as far as I'm aware, perfectly decent people, but like also really tied into a particular heavily gendered ideology, which Steve Albini definitely is. He is the most maskist of the mask, and while being a skinny little twerp, which sort of goes hand in hand, I've found. But I enjoy his music. B, thinks that the way that he has thought his music through, and C, find the way that people interact with his music who are not part of the demo who you would think would interact with his music all to be interesting and valuable, blah 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 blah. Miles of disclaimers with this shit. but I think that's a really good point. I think that this is also like not the sort of idea of this being a feminine approach to music, it is of course not limited to women. I think of people like John Roderick,
who's that? Help us out.
Sorry, Long Winters. People who and he's sort of like he ran for city council in Seattle. He's an NPR favorite, one of the internet Johns, alongside Darnell Hodgman, Linnell Flansburgh. But there is I feel like that you can try to break everything, and you can also try to get to a point where you're able to make a living doing the art. And the...
An oil derrick!
Oh, very good. And the...
cool. It's probably a little small on your screen, but it's out there on the ocean.
Okay, yeah.
There she blows.
Beautiful.
The commitment to... We're on Highway 1. This is kind of lovely. The commitment to sort of pruning the ecosystem of being a living touring band feels more to me like the project of that kind of art approach. It's like what art arises from like the touring and playing and recording and selling existence becoming like humane and self-sustaining rather than trying to hit a particular peak and then not to let go of that peak until you are forcibly removed from that peak by the action of time.
Sure.
I don't know where I was going with that.
I lost it at some point.
Yeah. I'm trying to keep what is like this going, despite the fact that it's an incredibly difficult topic for me to talk about.
I still don't know what we're talking about.
Oh yeah,
don't worry.
Why don't you contribute?
Why would you make me contribute when I don't know what we're talking about? I'm going to say some stupid shit about Muse or something.
What are your thoughts on masculinity?
Yeah, generally, actually, that's a better question.
I don't know. Masculinity is weird right now, isn't it? Like
right now,
it's I feel out.
Like there's a cultural lens which is becoming a mainstream cultural lens, and I'm going to sound all anti-SJW or something when I say this, but like art by white dudes. Which isn't like trying to distance itself from white dudeliness is kind of automatically viewed as mediocre in a certain light, and that's something that I find myself contending with as an artist. Is I find myself kind of predisposed to view myself as mediocre. So I don't know. I feel like that's the complex that I need to move away from.
And on the other hand, go ahead.
Yeah, I've always. I just like I can see what you're saying, and this is why I've always tried to avoid this sort of rhetoric, because it seems like a lose-lose situation. You know, if you're a woman and you subscribe to this rhetoric, then you can't win, and if you're a man and you subscribe to this rhetoric, when you do win, it's because you're evil. So no one is winning in this situation. And
but there's something true about that, isn't there? I mean, nobody wins under patriarchy.
Nobody
wins under God's world.
we're in this situation right now where there is a sizable minority which is claiming to be a majority in the culture which, you know, arrived on our doorstep with the at the end of the last election, which is feels entirely comfortable in dismissing anything that is not does not come with like violent contemptuous masculinity as a part of it with distrust,
right?
You know, and so it's like within the cultural context that we live in, there is this narrative to fight against, but there's also the narrative of your own the expectation that you have to transcend your own doodliness in order to produce anything of note.
I mean, but it kind of does come back around to the beginning, right? Like the beginning of this conversation, that there is a feeling that in order to make good art, you need to transcend your identity in general, whatever your identity may happen to be.
Yes, mm-hmm. There you go.
I think that the way that this narrative is useful is if you have not reckoned with this shit at all, then you're probably do not understand things well enough to make good art.
And you can't make good art. Yes, I agree.
That seems like a wise thing to say.
Yeah, the trick is having reckoned with it to...
Yeah, the trick is to think about yourself constantly.
Well, hey. You know, we do that. We do that as a matter of course. And we talk about ourselves constantly to the internet, even.
You're well on the way.
Yeah. Okay, so we're getting close to the end here. So while Josh enacts the ritual of parking...
Oh, boy.
Do you have any tips as to how we can become famous like you?
Just keep reckoning.
That's a really good one.
Just keep reckoning, yeah.
Yeah,
I think it's a mantra.
I think if we had a gift for the soundbite like that, I think we might be able to become famous. So. We used too many words. No, you do know. I think you do know.
I don't know. Don't ask me this.
No, I think... Oh, dear.
What's the matter?
I think Mr. Carseat Headrest here is someone who understands toiling in obscurity.
It has been a thing in the past that I've done.
That's definitely the case.
Toiling in obscurity is one possible way to find success.
Yeah.
Just have to do it for long enough.
When I watched that Jimmy Fallon clip I mentioned earlier, I was struck by the fact that it had, you know, a pretty good number of views, and it was, you know, obviously it was on Jimmy Fallon, so it's not a small deal, but all the comments basically were, I can't believe Will and the boys are on Jimmy Fallon.
Yeah. Yeah, there are a lot more people who knew us back then now than there were who knew us back then.
Oh, it's tossed me a low ball here.
That's a shame. It must want to... The roll of the dice has elected that we end this conversation relatively quickly. But I do have one other question that I'm genuinely curious about, which is if you are currently possessed with hatred for the thing that you made that everybody likes, how are you hoping to fix that going forward? What is the element that was present in that you wish to expunge from the next thing or the thing that needs to be added? I mean, that's a very difficult question, I understand, but I'm asking anyway.
Is that a bad question to ask?
No, it's a good question. It is a legitimate question. I would like to add more compassion to the next thing that I create. I think that the last record was awfully self-centered.
I was accelerated when you said that.
Among other things, you know, seeing a 100-paragraph long write-ups of your album really makes you fairly sure of what the problems with the record are. And
God, you know, I think the thing that I envy about your situation more than anything else is to be seen to an extent that you can have a better idea of what you're doing.
Do you want that? Do you wish that?
I wish to be scrutinized.
Had one blog post that went, you know, got some attention, and I found a Reddit thread, and it was full of good advice.
Yeah, right? Like, a lot of people out there are smart and can tell you things about yourself.
This is a thing, though. There's a sweet spot, and I hit this sweet spot probably a year before I signed to Matador. There's a sweet spot where you're doing what you're doing long enough that there are people paying attention, but they're all good people because they've sought you out. And once you pass that point, a certain level of saturation starts happening, and the majority of people who are encountering your work are not people who actually sought it out or people who actually want to experience it. So I much preferred the discourse that I was seeing on my art before I got signed. It is after a certain point, it becomes impossible to find the good stuff, basically.
So this is another case of needing to curate that ecosystem rather than sliding into it, growth.
Expanded. I don't know what that means, but beware.
I'm sorry. I'm expanding on the thing that I said earlier, which I said in a way that prevented people from understanding it, so that I wouldn't get in trouble for having said it.
Well, that's one way to fame.
I found that like writing things that people are clearly enjoying because it baffles them has actually gotten me a fair amount of attention. So,
yeah, I mean,
there's that route.
I've read Joyce. I had a Joyce phase. I've moved on.
I don't think it satisfies in the long term.
Dubliners is my favorite.
Yeah, that's the joist that is easily understood.
Yeah.
But anyway, I think that's an excellent little piece of knowledge there, Josh. I think we should endeavor to be less famous than Car Seat Headrest, but only just
hit the sweet spot and just keep it going. And sabotage yourself at that point. That's the secret, and then work yourself back to it.
But you have to be careful about how you sabotage yourself. Like, you don't want to become more famous for being terrible, or less famous for not being good anymore.
We just have to resist the urge to put ourselves into the work. We have to make this as anonymous and feelings free as possible, so that people who dig abstraction are the only people who listen to Tri.
And now that we've said this, there's no way we can do it.
But anyway,
start a solo project.
My Dark Souls videos.
That's not so much starting a solo project as
resuming it.
Throwing off this guy who's been sucking up your time and attention for the last 3 years.
It's wonderful. You're my secret weapon. I can like ask a question and Isaac will just ramble off a bunch of really good stuff.
Sorry, you wanted to say something, and you are here theoretically to say things. So
no, I had nothing to say. I never have anything to say.
I like you, Will Toledo. I'm glad that you messaged me about the online comic Crow Killers, which we should shout out now because
Now that we've done the real Trex with you, can we do a Trex which is nothing but Crow Killers? Like something that neither of our audiences will particularly care about.
That sounds good to me.
Yeah,
cool. We'll do a return engagement about Crow Killers, but we'll have to make Josh
read it.
Read at least a single page of Crow Killers.
Yeah, that'll be a good excuse to do it.
Yeah. All right. Anyway, dude.
I'll talk to you then.
Cool. Yeah.
Goodbye, everybody.
Bye.
Goodbye.